Hi and welcome. Now in this session, as you know, we are going to show you just the images of ENT, the important images that are necessary for the MCI screening examination 2020. So I'll show you roughly 45 images, and they are all very, very important. Just the images and a slight background about each of them. So we'll do it very fast. Right. Now my name is Dr. Sanjay Agarwal, as you know. We'll start with the first image. Now this, as you can see, this image of the skull from outside the lateral view. And this green bone is the temporal bone. In ENT, temporal bone is the most important bone that you have to know, and you should be able to recognize this temporal bone. Of course, temporal bone is made up of number of bones, but you should be able to identify this bone if they give you an image-based question on temporal. Next is, this is a normal tympanic membrane. Now, normal tympanic membrane, please note the color, which is pearly white. And one or two things you should be able to identify is this bone that you see. This bone is handle of malleus. And this bone, which is projecting out, is the lateral process of malleus. Right. So on the normal tympanic membrane, you should be able to identify at least these two structures very, very easily and prominently. We'll continue with tympanic membrane, but before that, these are the three ossicles. This is malleus. This one is incus. This one is stapes. And this is foot plate of stapes. Okay. And this, of course, is the tympanic membrane, TM. So every time I write TM, it's tympanic membrane. So this joint, the two joints here, this is incudostapedial joint. Because it is a joint between the incus and the stapes. And this is incudomalleolar joint. Okay, so you can try and identify these joints as well. And the details of the joints, of course, we have done already in the lectures. The next image is middle ear. Now, this is a very, very, very important image. This is middle ear, or you can call it a middle ear cleft. If you say middle ear is okay, if you call it middle ear cleft, it's actually better that way. Now, this is extremely important image, and they'll give you a similar kind of image, and they can point at anything, and they may ask you to identify that particular structure. So it's very important, and you must be able to identify all the structures. See, this is the anterior end. This end is the anterior end, and this end is the posterior end. Right. Now, on the anterior end, the two important things, this opening and this root. The lower, which is bigger opening, I'm sure you all know, is the eustachian tube opening. And this is canal for tensor tympanum. Right. And this artery, which is actually outside the ear, but lies on the anterior relation to the middle ear, is just anterior to the middle ear, is the internal carotid artery. Okay. Now this bulge kind of thing, this bulge is the promontory. All right here. So this is your promontory. And on the posterior part of the promontory, there are two windows. This is the RW, round window. And this here is the OW, oval window. So these are the two windows, oval window and round window. And just above this oval window, this fascia nerve, this nerve that you see, this nerve is the fascia. This nerve is the fascia. Okay, this nerve is the fascia nerve. So I'll remove this, what I'm drawing, so that you can appreciate this nerve. So please appreciate this fascia nerve very nicely. It's a very important structure. Now you already know the oval window and the round window. And this ossicle that you see, this ossicle, this one, this ossicle is the stapes, third ossicle, stapes. Of course, we know that a stapes goes and fits into the oval window. This window is oval window. This is stapes, and this is a foot plate. This is a foot plate of stapes. This is a foot plate, right? This is antrum. This is antrum. Okay. And this bulge that you see, which is pointed with the green, this is a bulge of the lateral semicircular canal. This is called bulge of lateral semicircular canal. Okay, so once again, this is a middle ear cleft, or simply put, middle ear. On the anterior side, you have internal carotid artery, your station tube opening, and your canal for the insert intimal muscle. In the center, there is promontory. Behind the promontory, this oval window, this round window, sorry, this oval window. Oval window has this stapes, ossicles, stapes. And just above the oval window, this nerve is the facial nerve. This nerve is the facial nerve going down. So this foramen is stylomastoid foramen. We all know that facial nerve comes out of the stylomastoid foramen. Right. This is antrum. This is antrum. And this is the bulge of the lateral semicircular. This is the bulge of the lateral semicircular. So one of the most important images from the ear is this image. So please identify very nicely all the things that I'm trying to show you in this particular image. Okay. Next. Now this is how the audiometry looks like. This is a audiometry graph. Audiometry graphs. Now, ideally, not for you, but for PZ, they show you such graphs and they ask you what is the problem. Is it conductive hearing loss? Is it sensory neural hearing loss? Is it AC? Is it DC, right ear, left ear, all that? For you, it is not important, all these things. So don't indulge. Only see, look at this graph and this graph, very similar. These are audiograms, okay, threshold of audiometry. Now, what you have to remember, see, if the audiogram is shown with red color, drawn with red color, it is right ear. See, right ear. R for right, R for red. That's how you remember. And if it is blue color, like this one is blue, it is for left ear. So one, this you have to know, is it right ear or left ear, depending on the color, as I said. And if you look at the symbol, can you see the symbols? Yeah, it is circle, circle. Can you see these are circles? Circles here. But look at here, cross. These are cross, X, not circle. So this is another thing you have to be able to notice. So if you look at this one, these are cross. Can you see these are cross? Right. Now, cross or X in audiometry is showing you air conduction of left ear. So this is important. So how do you depict air conduction of the left ear with the symbol X? So this one, as you can see, I've shown you. So this graph is showing the air conduction of the left ear. And it is blue also, you can make out blue color. So I already told you blue is left ear. Or if they show you this kind of graph, again, you see, can you see this gloss? This is again AC of left ear, air conduction of left ear. You can make out once again very easily, very prominently, no problem. So that's another important thing that you must be able to know. And right ear is red color, left ear is blue color. So these are audiograms. And significant, if you want to know, can you see this audiogram is going like this? There's a dip, it goes like this, and there's a sudden dip like this. The dip, it has 4,000. Can you see this is 4? This is 4. 4,000 actually. And dip at 4,000, 4K, is noise trauma, is due to noise trauma. If somebody is exposed to very loud noise and there's a trauma to the ear to the noise, then you see this kind of audiogram. So if I show you this audiogram, I tell you what is the diagnosis. We say both ears have noise trauma. See, right ear also it is deep, left ear also, blue one also deep. So it is bilateral noise trauma. And you, I'm sure you know, if it is deep at 2000, it is called Cahart's notch. And it is seen in otosclerosis. Isn't it? This is a very well-known MCQ, very well-known fact also. Most of you, I'm sure you know this already, that if there's a dip at 2000, which is this one, 2000. So it is like this. In 2000, it is like this here. But this one is 4000. So when you get a dip, you have to be careful. Is it 2000, which is this one, or 4000? Different. 2000 is a Cahart's notch, otosclerosis. 4000 is noise induced hearing loss. Okay. So very, very important, these simple facts. Now let's proceed. This is Sigel's speculum. So this is a ear speculum. That means it goes inside the ear. And this is a bulb. When you pump this bulb with a hand, the air will go inside in the ear. Ear is this side. So it will go into the ear. And this is done, used for various things. It is used to check fistula sign. It is done, used to check the fistula sign. Very important. It is used to check Brown sign. It is used to check Galle's test and medication also. It is also used for medication of ear. So these are some of the important uses. You can call it check, or you can call it uses of this very, very important instrument called Sigel's speculum. Okay. So identify this very important instrument. Next. Now these are tympanic membrane of ASO, TM of acute suppurative otitis media. Tympanic membrane of acute suppurative otitis media. This is bulging tympanic membrane. Can you see there is a bulge? It is not. Remember the normal membrane I had shown you, pearly color. This is red. This is described as cartwheel appearance. And can you see this is fluid level? This is the fluid that you see. So this is the fluid level, which is seen, and they are all seen in ASU. These are all findings of ASU. So this is another very, very important slide that you should be able to identify, the slides of ASU. So different patient can have different finding in ASU. And one thing I can tell you, that if they show you the slide or the finding of tympanic membrane, they will not give you a spot diagnosis. That means they will not only give you this image and make diagnosis. What is the diagnosis? There'll always be a question associated with it. There'll be a proper question, and along with the question, there'll be an image, one of these three images, a very similar looking image, and then they'll ask you. So don't think that they'll ask you, just show the image and ask you, what is this? No, they will not. That you can be very, very sure. ESM, you all know, is very, very important disease of the ear. Right. Then we have blue ear. This is blue ear images, which is also called SOM, serosotitis media. Look at the images of ASOM and blue ear. They're so different. This is gray tympanic membrane. This is called retracted tympanic membrane. And this is fluid air bubbles. You can make out air bubbles. These are the air bubbles. Okay. And they are all seen in blue ear or serosotitis media. So once again, I'll tell you that they will most probably not ask you a direct question, just give you the image and ask you the diagnosis. Again, there'll be a history. Now look at the middle one, the retracted tympanic membrane. And through that, you can see other things also. So this bulge is the promontory. This is the promontory. This is handle of malleus. And this one is incus. Incus. So through the retracted tympanic membrane, you can see other stuff of the middle ear. Through the membrane, you can see. And if you remember the normal membrane, in the normal membrane, remember I've shown you one where you can only see handle of malleus. And what are the other things I had shown you? Lateral process, remember? But here you can see incus also, promontory also, other things also. The other things also, I don't want to show you too many things because otherwise you'll get confused. I'm only telling you the important ones. Okay. The next image. This is the first image is myringotomy being done. Myringotomy surgery. So this is a surgery of myringotomy. You can see a hole is being created on the tympanic membrane. And these two, there's grommet insertion. The grommet is being inserted into the ear through that hole that you have created, right? And this is done for blue ear or SOM. I just told you blue ear is SOM. So this is for blue ear or SOM, myringotomy and grommet. And this is done in which quadrant? It is done in anteroinferior quadrant. Right. Done. So very, very important image. Then we have central perforation of tympanic membrane. So this is central perforation of tympanic membrane. This is the perforation that you see. Okay. And through the perforation, You can see this P, promontory. This is promontory and this is oval window. Round window. So you can see the round window and the promontory through the perforation. And in which disease do you get central perforation? Central perforation is seen in, say, CSU. That means this is a case of safe CSU. This is a patient of safe CSU. Another very important fact that you must realize. Okay? Right. So this is, again, they'll give you a history and they can give this kind of an image and ask you to make a diagnosis, safe CSU. What is the treatment for central perforation? The treatment is meningoplasty. That means if they ask you the treatment of this condition, you say meningoplasty is the treatment that I have to do in this patient. Okay. Now this is a patient of acute mastoiditis. Can you see this is behind the pinna? This is pinna. And behind the pinna, there is a swelling, mastoid area, this area, which is this area, if you can see. And this finding is described as ironed out mastoid. So this finding is, the disease is acute mastoiditis, and the finding is ironed out mastoid. Right. And can you see this bulge? This is retroaural abscess. This bulge is the, this area is the small area that I've encircled. The whole thing is ironed out mastoid. The whole thing. Can you see the whole thing? Skin is very smooth and slightly reddish in color, smooth and red. So that's called ironed out mastoid. And in the center, there's a very small bulge, almost an abscess. And because this is behind the pinna, it is called retroaural abscess, sometimes also called postaural abscess. Okay, both are same, retroaural abscess and postaural abscess, same thing, a patient of acute mastoiditis. Very important. All right. Now this is, can you tell me what is it? This is rising sun sign. Rising sun sign. Which disease? Rising sun sign is a feature of which disease? Glomus tumor. Yes. Correct. So this is a glomus tumor. Rising sun. So this is the tympanic membrane. See? This whole thing is tympanic membrane. And here is the tumor. Red vascular tumor like a rising sun. You know, you all know rising sun also looks very red and it comes from below like this one. That's why it is called rising sun. What is the diagnosis? Glomus tumor. So this is the image. You should be able to identify once again. A very popular image of tympanic membrane. So this will complete all the important images of tympanic membrane also. Normal membrane, ASUM, blue ear, retraction, air bubbles, perforation, rising sun sign, things like that. Then this is middle ear. With stapedectomy surgery. And stapedectomy surgery is done for which disease? It is done for otosclerosis. So this patient has otosclerosis, and for that, the surgery was done, stapedectomy. And can you see the prosthesis? This is, prosthesis means artificial stapes. This is prosthesis or artificial stapes in the middle ear. So this is malleus, this is incus, and instead of stapes, we have artificial stapes. And this is foot plate. This is Eustachian tube. Right. So again, it's a image of middle ear. Here they can ask you malleus, incus, stapes, foot plate, prosthesis, Eustachian tube. All these things can be asked in the exam. Okay. Next one. You all know this is a maneuver called Higgs halpipe maneuver. And it is done for a disease called BPPV. What is BPPV? BPPV is benign paroxysmal positional vertigo. This is the full form of BPPV, benign paroxysmal positional vertigo. Okay, so you can see the doctor, this is the patient. Obviously, you can see the patient is made to lie down suddenly from sitting to the lying down position, and the head is hanging 30 degrees. This angle is 30 degrees, and the head is from this side, it is turned to the other side. It is turned to the other side, and then the patient is made to sit suddenly. Right? So this is used to diagnose BPP for diagnosis. Diagnosis of BPPV, benign paroxysmal positional vertigo. So please look at this image very carefully. But the doctor is making the patient's head turn, then lie down 30 degree hanging downwards, the head is turned again to the opposite side and made to sit down. And if the nystagmus starts, it is positive test. There's no nystagmus, it is a negative test. So we're looking for the nystagmus on changing this particular position in this patient. This is another image, and this is called Simmons maneuver. Simmons maneuver is for treatment of BPPV. So both are used for the same disease. This one is for diagnosis, and this one is for treatment. For treatment of BPPV, Simmons maneuver. This maneuver is also called canalolith repositioning maneuver. Canalolith. This is the correct spelling, canalolith repositioning maneuver. Simmons maneuver. So there is no doctor here. And it's cyclical. See, it is going round and round. Cyclical. It is done many times. Whereas this one is not cyclical. You can see it is not going again and again. This is going again and again. Cyclical. Simmons maneuver. Very important name for treatment. BPP. I think this will complete all the images from ear. And then I think we'll go to the nose. Let me see if there's any other image from ear also. Yeah, this is another image from ear. This is a gadolinium MRI. It is MRI showing what? Acoustic neuron. So this is a gadolinium MRI, as I've written here, and it's showing you a acoustic neuroma, which is also called vestibular schwannoma. vestibular shunt. So this is the tube. That vestibular shunt at CP angle. This area is called CP angle. The area where the tumor lies, this area is called cerebellopontine angle. CP angle is a short form, cerebellopontine angle. Very, very important. This is a gold standard investigation. Gold standard investigation. For, you know, a caustic neuroma. And that's why this is another very important image that you should be able to identify and be able to answer the questions. Now we come to throat. Now this is X-ray of nasopharynx. You can make out the, this is nasopharynx. This area is the nasopharynx. So we are trying to look at the nasopharynx in this particular X. And what do you see? You see this. And this is adenoid hypertrophy. This is adenoid hypertrophy. So once again, I can understand that to diagnose an adenoid hypertrophy is not easy. It is slightly difficult unless you are, this is your adenoid. But again, if they give you such a question, they will always give you a history along with that, a case. They will not give you just this image and ask you what is the diagnosis. Not possible. So they'll give you a patient, a child, usually a child with sleeping with open, with breathing through open mouth, with mouth breathing. You know, child with mouth breathing, child with sleeping with open mouth. Or a child with blue ear. Even blue ear, child can have adenoid hypertrophy. The cause of blue ear, we have seen the tympanic membrane of blue ear. So this is a nasopharynx of blue ear, which is adenoid hypertrophy. So it could be any of these three. Next one. This is corneal atresia, which is a congenital defect. Of bucco nasal membrane. Bucco nasal membrane. So, can you look at this side and this side? Compare the two sides. This is a normal side. This is diseased side. So, there's a atresia here. And this is atresia of the quena because of this membrane called bucco nasal membrane. So this is unilateral. This is unilateral corneal atresia. One side. The other side is normal. So you could get an image showing bilateral corneal atresia. In bilateral corneal atresia, both sides will have this atresia. This side will also have a blockade like here, somewhere here. Will be blockade like this one. This is a blockade on this side. So if the blockade is on the other side also, then it becomes bilateral corneal atresia. But this is unilateral. This is maxilla. So this is M maxilla. And this is what? What is this structure which I am pointing this one? Septum. This is nasal septum. What is this? This is turbinate. This is most probably inferior turbinate. You cannot make out properly. Most probably inferior turbinate, but it is definitely a turbinate. So again, in a CT scan of paranasal sinuses, you can see the maxilla, you the turbinate, the septum, the quena, quena latrasia, all these things can be seen very easily. Next. Now, this is antral sign, which is also called Hallman-Miller sign. So can you see, this is the maxilla, I told you, M, maxilla, in the previous image. And look at the posterior wall of the maxilla on this side, is pushed. This is maxilla again, this is pushed. It is called anterior bowing of posterior maxillary wall. Anterior bowing of posterior maxillary wall, and this is called antral sign or Hallman-Miller sign. So look, this side is normal. Normal side. This is pushed wall. Posterior wall is pushed. Can you see the normal and the pushed wall? Very easy. And which disease is this seen in? This is seen in juvenile nasopharyngeal angiopathy. In short, JNA. So everything is important. The name of the disease, which you see this sign, juvenile nasopharyngeal angiofibroma. The name of the sign, the two names, antral sign, Hallman-Miller. What is the finding? The finding is anterior bowing of the posterior wall of the maxilla. And the image you can see, compared with the normal side, the posterior wall is not pushed on the side, the disease, the tumor, it is pushed. This is the tumor. This is the tumor. This is the tumor. You know, you can make out very easily. And the tumor is pushing the posterior wall of the maxilla. This is antral sign. Okay. Now, this is ranula. In the floor of the mouth, this cyst in floor of mouth. Can you see? And it is with blue capsule. Blue capsule. Can you see this cyst? In the floor of the mouth with blue. If you compare this capsule of this cyst, it is relatively blue compared to the rest. And the name of the disease is ranula. And this is a definition of ranula. This one, retention cyst of sublingual gland. So this is the definition or the diagram of the ranula. And it is on one side. Not in the midline, not in the other side, not both sides. It is only one side of the midline. Can you make out? So these are important features. What is the treatment for ranula? The treatment is marsupialization. This is the treatment. Marsupialization. Ranula. Right. Now, this is Boyle's baby's mouth gap. Very important. It is used to keep the mouth open during two surgeries. One is tonsillectomy and during adenoidectomy. Okay. So these surgeries, tonsillectomy and adenoidectomy, the mouth is kept open using this instrument called Boyle's baby's mouth gap. Simple. Now another instrument, again for tonsillectomy, is called Eve's tonsillar snare. What does this do? This will cut, or let's say it will crush and cut the tonsil. We crush and then cut the tonsil. The instrument is called Eaves Tonsillar Snare. Now you can see Boyle Davis mouth cap. In use. So Boyle Davis mouth gag is being used in this particular image for tonsillectomy or adenoidectomy surgery. This is how you use this one. Okay. One more instrument is this one. It's called Sinclair Thompson Adenoid Curette. And from the name you understand, it is for adenoidectomy. This is used for the surgery of adenoidectomy. You can see different sizes. Different sizes for different age. So patient will have different age, and so you need different size. This is simple. This is Quincy. AKA peritonsillar abscess. And so this bulge, as you can see, this bulge, it's Quincy or peritonsillar abscess, almost touching the uvula. You can see it is almost touching the uvula. And we all know this condition is compared to hot potato condition. It is also called the hot potato condition, Quincy. And the treatment is immediate incision and drainage, followed by interval tonsillectomy. Right, Quincy. Now, these are the cartilages of larynx. From different angles, this is the anterior view, this is the posterior view, this is also posterior. So, this cartilage is thyroid, this is thyroid, this is thyroid. And below, this is cricoid. This is cricoid. This is cricoid. This is epiglottis. This is epiglottis. And this is epiglottis. And these are arytenoids. This is arytenoid. Arytenoid cannot be seen from the anterior end. It is behind. Right? Now, one more thing you can remember in this diagram is this membrane. This membrane is thyrohyoid membrane. Thyrohyoid. So this is thyrohyoid membrane. This is thyrohyoid membrane. Right? Now these are different types of laryngoscope. The first one is indirect laryngoscope. It's called indirect laryngoscopy mirror, and this is direct laryngoscopy. Look at the indirect and direct laryngoscope. Now, this is fiber optic laryngoscopy. You can make out there is a fiber optic cable. And what is the last one? This is stroboscope. So stroboscope has almost, it has something which looks like direct laryngoscope, and this one which looks like fiber optic laryngoscope. Isn't it? Almost, it looks like that it has direct and fiber optic. So in this is a shortcut how to remember how does a stroboscope look like. It is a combination of all, almost. But these are different kind of laryngoscopes that you have to be able to identify for laryngoscopy. For examination of the larynx, they are all used for examination of the larynx. Now this is very easy. This is omega-shaped epiglottis. And we all know omega-shaped epiglottis is seen in which disease? It is seen in laryngomalacia. So omega we write like this. See, if you do this and this and this, it is almost like this one, omega. That's why it's called omega shaped epiglottis laryngomalacia. Most common congenital disease. Laryngomalacia is a most common congenital disease. Okay. Then this is very, very important thumb sign. Very important thumb sign. So this that you see is shape of thumb. Epiglottis. The epiglottis is thumb shape, and that's why thumb sign. And what is the disease? The disease is acute epiglottitis. The disease is epiglottitis. Okay. Very important. Very, very important. The next is also very important. Steeple sign. And we all know steeple sign is seen in Croup is also called laryngotracheobronchitis. It's a viral disease. So you see, this is like this. Airway is like this. You see this? Explained here. Stipple on the top of church, you have stipple. It looks, the shape is like that. Stipples. Laryngotracheobronchitis group. Now we'll have a couple of images of the vocal cords. They are very important. Again, the extremely, extremely important, three or four images we'll see. And again, there will never be a spot diagnosis. There'll be a small history associated with this. Now these are vocal cord nodules, both. Both the images are showing these are nodules. Vocal cord nodules. They are usually seen in singers. Singers nodule. They are very small, as you can make out also, and bilateral. They are very small, as you can make out, they are bilateral and both sides. Singers, vocal cord nodule. Voice rest is the treatment. Now the next is vocal cord polyp. Can you see this polyp? It is unilateral and large and fleshy. Can you make out the look? Is very fleshy, unilateral, and they're larger than nodule. Look at the nodule. and calling surgery is the treatment. What surgery? MLS. Microscopic laryngeal surgery. MLS it's called. The treatment. This is intubation granuloma. On arytenoid cartilage. So they seen on arytenoid cartilage due to intubation. That's why it's called intubation granuloma. It can be unilateral or bilateral. So in this particular image, it is bilateral, but it is not always bilateral. It can be unilateral also. This is laryngeal papilloma. Laryngeal papilloma is also called juvenile onset recurrent laryngeal papillomatosis. This is also called juvenile onset recurrent respiratory papillomatosis, JORRP. Okay. This is laryngocele. This is usually seen in trumpet blowers. So there is swelling in the neck, and this are the laryngocele swelling. This is laryngocele swelling, and this is laryngocele swelling. So the key word is trumpet blower with neck swelling and X-ray or CT scan. Laryngocele. So this will complete larynx and throat, and now we come to the nose. This is nasal septum. Nasal septum has 7 bones and 3 cartilages, but you don't have to remember all of them. You have to remember separate cartilage, 1 vomer bone and ethmoid bone. So you must be able to identify these 3 things. Very, very important MCQ. Very important. Separate cartilage, ethmoid bone, and vomer bone. This is adenoid. This is sphenoid. And this is eustachian tube opening. In the nasopharynx, right? The nasal septum with the main bones and cartilages. Now these are CT scan of paranasal sinus. So CT scan of paranasal sinus, the first one is normal scan. In the normal scan, you can see maxilla. This is maxilla. These are turbinates, inferior turbinate. This is middle turbinate. These are ethmoid. Can you see these are ethmoids? This is maxillary polyp. The next one is polyp. Polyp in the maxilla. So this is maxillary polyp, as you can see. This one. Second image. And third one is a double density scan in fungal sinusitis. So these are double density. Can you see the white thing? These are different density. So that's why they are called double density. So like a polyp with white thing, which is calcium. This white thing is calcium. And they are seen in fungal sinusitis. Very important MCQ this one. So these are different types of scans of the maxilla depending on the disease. It could be normal first one, polyp second one, and double density in fungal sinusitis. Again, very important scan. They can ask in the exam. And again, there will be some history along with this. Now, very important is the first one, where you should be able to identify maxilla, septum, inferior turbinate, middle turbinate, ethmoids, things like that. They can ask you to identify. Now, this is ethmoidal problem. Can you see ethmoid? I told you in this image that this is the ethmoid area, isn't it? Now, this is maxilla. So polyp in the maxilla is maxillary polyp. And if the polyp is here, in this area, then it will be ethmoidal polyp. So look at this. Polyp is here. Both sides. So bilateral ethmoidal. So this is maxilla. Maxilla is by and large okay. The polyp is mainly in the ethmoid. Ethmoidal polyp and maxillary polyp, one should be able to differentiate these two easily without any problem. Next one. This is Cottle's test done for DNS. DNS stands for deviated nasal septum. Cottle's test is done for deviated nasal septum. So this is a Cottle's test, which is done for deviated nasal septum, which is also called DNS. Not done commonly, but the image is very, very important from the exam point of view. Where you pull the teeth on the side, the patient has obstruction. This is rhinophyma. Very easy. Potato nose. This can be a spot diagnosis. They can just give you this image. Can you look at the nose? Their nose is not as smooth. So this can be a spot diagnosis. They'll just give you this image and they ask, what is this? Right? It's a very, very, very important MCQ. Very, very important MCQ. Very commonly asked them. Potato nose. Then this is rhinoscleroma. Can you see this? Scleros tissue. Caused by Klebsiella. Rhinoscleromatis. This is also called woody nose. So like the previous one is called potato nose. This one is called woody nose. Like a wood. It's a wood heart. This is wood heart. So woody nose. Look at the redness. It is not very red. It's red. It's not very red, this growth. But next one, look at this deep red. This is fleshy red. May bleed. So compared to the previous one, this is fleshy red and it may bleed. So it's called bleeding polyp. That's why it's called bleeding polyp, or sometimes called strawberry polyp. What is it? It is rhinosporidiosis. And the drug of choice is Dapsone. The drug of choice, Dapsone. Next one. Now this is blowout fracture. It is a fracture of floor of orbit. So this is a finding, and the finding is called teardrop sun. So this image is actually trying to show you the teardrop sign, a finding in blowout fracture, a fracture of the blow floor of the orbit. So this orbital floor, if you look at the CT scan, the second one, the orbital floor is supposed to be like this. And there's supposed to be no tissue here. It's supposed to be like this. See? This is normal. This is how normal CT scan look like. But this is not normal. I'll remove what I've drawn. There's a fracture here, and the tissue of the orbit is hanging down like a teardrop from the eye, teardrop sign. Right? Very important. And the last image that we are going to see is on grain CT. This line is on grain CT. This is drawn from medial canthus of eye to angle of mandible on grain CT. Okay, now if this is the maxilla, this line divides the maxilla into suprastructure, which is above the line. Supra means above, and this area which is infrastructure. And this line is used for, see, it is for maxilla, maxillary carcinoma. This is very important. This line is used for maxillary carcinoma. This was an MCQ already asked in your exam. Right. So what are the importance? Suprastructure carcinoma has poor prognosis. So if the carcinoma is here, it is poor prognosis. And infrastructure carcinoma has good prognosis. So if it is here, it is good. So basically, the Ongren's line helps us know the prognosis of the carcinoma of maxilla. Right? So Ongren's line is a very, very important line for maxilla. So these are the images that I wanted to show you in ENT. Not too many images, but it will make sense that you remember all this. When they ask you images, I'm pretty sure and confident that they're going to ask you from this only, or very related to this. So I wish and hope that this was useful to you. And I'm very confident that you guys are working really hard, because there's no shortcut to success. And because the time for your exam is very less, so, and there's lockdown all around, you can't go out. So the best thing you can do is sit in your homes and rooms wherever you're staying, and only study and study and study. Revision is the key, as I always tell you, that the more number of times you revise, the better it is going to be for you. And images, they're going to ask you definitely. So we are running this session, image-based session. We are just telling about images, and it's going to be a very, very useful session. So please read all the topics, all the subjects, all the images, look at them, because it's going to be very, very useful. So with this, I thank you for attending the session, and God bless. And we all wish that you come out with flying colors. Thank you once again.